A very good morning, dear children. Today we are going to continue with chapter 15, that is life processes in living organisms. Today we will be learning coordination in plants. Now it is very common for students to get confused between control and coordination, and that is why it is necessary that you understand these two terms and the differences between them. So what is control? We know that multicellular organisms have various different organs which work in different systems in the body. Okay, when these systems are properly regulated, that is they are working systematically, that is called as control. What is coordination? When these systems work in the proper sequence, that is called as coordination. So let's look at the difference between the two. Control means when the systems are working appropriately, that is control. When these systems are working in proper sequence, that is one after the other, in proper sequence, that is coordination. So in control, it is systematic regulation, and coordination is proper sequence. You should understand these two. Control means systematic working, and coordination means processing in proper sequence. That is called as coordination. Okay. Now, in any multicellular organism or in any living organism, when everything is working systematically, that means when all the processes are coordinated well, the organism is said to be in the state of equilibrium, or the organism is said to be stable. This state of equilibrium or stability is called as homeostasis. Okay, so when everything is working perfectly well, that condition of the organism is called homeostasis. So these three concepts have to be clear, that is control, coordination and homeostasis. Now, plants do not have any kind of nervous system, they do not have muscular system, but still, even in the absence of these two systems, plants show certain movements. These movements that are seen in the plants are mainly because of stimulus or because of some kind of signal in the environment. So today we are going to learn about such movements that are seen in the plants because of certain stimulus. The movements that you see in the plants are called as tropism or tropic movement. So let's look at an example. The first example we are going to learn is the movement of the shoot system in response to light. We know that plants normally they bend towards the source of light. This bending of the plant towards light is called phototropism. Here the stimulus is light. As you can see, the plant is moving towards, or it's bending towards the source of light. That is why this is called phototropism. If you break the word into two, photo stands for light and tropism stands for movement. So movement towards light is called as phototropism. Now, in this example that we just now saw, you will see that we know plant is made up of the shoot system and the root system. Shoot is the upper part and root is the lower part. Shoot, that is the upper part of the plant, always bends towards light. That is, it is bending towards the stimulus. It is moving towards the stimulus. But if you look at the root, it is not moving towards light. It goes deep down into the soil. It is going away from the stimulus. Any movement that is towards the stimulus is said to be positive, and any movement which is away from the stimulus is said to be negative. So here in phototropism, the shoot system shows positive phototropism, that is it's moving towards the stimulus, whereas the root system is showing negative phototropism, that is moving away from the stimulus. Okay, let's look at another example. We know that the root system of the plant normally moves towards gravity. In this slide, you will see two pictures. One on the left, which shows the root system going deep down into the soil, that is towards gravity. And on the right side of the slide, you will see the plant's root system moving towards the source of water. This slide shows two movements. One that is on the left is gravitropic movement. Gravitropic, if I break the word into two, gravi stands for gravitation and tropic stands for movement. Movement of the root system towards gravitation is called gravitropic movement. And the one on the right shows hydrotropic movement. If you break the word into two, it is hydro, which stands for water, and tropic stands for movement. Movement of the root system towards water is hydrotropic movement. Okay, so let's look at this. The root system moves towards gravity, that is, it's going down first and then it's moving towards water. So it's showing me gravitropic and hydrotropic. Okay. Now here again, in this, that is gravitropic and hydrotropic, my root system and the shoot system show different movement. Positive geotropism, that means positive movement towards the stimulus, is shown by the root. The shoot goes opposite, that is, the shoot does not go towards gravity, it does not go towards water, it is going away from gravitation and away from water. So the shoot system shows negative geotropism. You must have heard about climbers, and in this picture the brown stick that you see is the bamboo stick. The climber has tendrils. These tendrils, what they do is that for their growth, they hold on to any kind of support that they have nearby. They wound around it, take the support of that and grow. Such kind of movement is called thymotropic movement. Thymo here stands for touch. So the tendrils touch and take the support of anything that is hard enough so that they can get a support and they start growing. This is called thymotropic movement. In plants, normally you see certain movements in response to specific chemicals. This movement towards the chemicals is called chemotropic movement. We have heard about, or we have learnt a lot about, the growth of the pollen tube towards the ovule. What is that? Let's take a look at it. We know that the pollen grain that descends on the stigma brings about the generation of the pollen tube, which moves towards the ovule. This movement is called chemotropism. If you break the word, chemo stands for chemical and tropism stands for movement. Movement towards the stimulus of chemical, or movement towards the chemical, is called as chemotropism. Not just that, we have many hormones that work and help in the growth of the plant, as you can see here on the slide. Here it shows the apical part of the plant, that is the upper part of the plant, and the red spots or the red dots that you see is the hormone auxin. It has been seen that wherever there is more amount of auxin hormone, it helps in enlargement of the cells. Here, as you can see, the shoot part or the upper part of the plant or the shoot system, enlargement of that plant takes place, or elongation of the cells take place, because of the hormone auxin. Similarly, the hormone gibberellin. Gibberellin is a hormone which helps in enlargement of the stem or elongation of the stem. Similarly, the hormone cytokinin. Cytokinin helps in the cell division of the plant cells. Now, till now, hormone auxin, hormone gibberellin, hormone cytokinin, all of them were helping in the growth of the plant. But there are two hormones called abscisic acid and ethylene which bring about, or they stop or prevent the growth of the plant. But why does a hormone prevent the growth of the plant? For example, you must have seen leaves falling off from trees. This is not because the plant has become weak. It is one way of helping the plant grow. If the plant has shortage of water, it will make the leaves fall. Why? Because we know water in the plant is lost because of evaporation from the leaf surface. So, if the leaves fall off, the amount of water that is going to be lost reduces and the plant can save on water. So, falling off leaves is one such example of the hormone abscisic acid. So, we can say that plant hormones can be of two types, growth promoters and growth inhibitors. Growth promoters, examples are auxins, as we saw, it brings about enlargement of the shoot cells. Cytokinins brings about cell division. Gibberellin helps in stem elongation. All three of them help in the growth of the plant, and that is why they are called growth promoters. Ethylene and abscisic acid, as I already told you, it brings about prevention of growth of the plant, but this has a lot of effect based upon environmental condition. If the environmental condition is harsh, then for surviving in that harsh environment, these two hormones bring about prevention of its growth so that when the conditions become favorable, that time the plant can grow at a much higher or good rate. So, ethylene and abscisic acid are the two growth inhibitor plant hormones. Thymotropism, hydrotropism, phototropism, geotropism, chemotropism. This is what we've just now seen. All these movements are called as growth relevant movements. Why are they called growth relevant? Because they are helping the growth of the plant. However, we have certain movements called as growth irrelevant movements. Why are they called growth irrelevant? It's mainly because there are many movements in the plant which does not lead to the plant's growth. This is called as growth irrelevant movements. You must have seen the plant mimosa, also called as touch me not. And you must have seen that movement occurs at the places wherever it has been touched. This is mainly because a plant uses some electrochemical impulses for the transfer of information from one place to another. What does that mean? The plant cells, they change their shape by increasing or decreasing the water content, thereby bringing about the movement of the plant. Lotus flower opens during daytime and tuberose, that is polyanthus, opens at night. The fibrils that are present on the leaves of the insectivorous plants Drosera, it bends inward as soon as the insect lands on the leaves and it surrounds the insects from all the sides. Venus flytrap. This is a plant which smells like flowers and because of which the insect visits that flower. The minute the insect sits on it, the trap closes and traps the insect by the plant. Some fruits, they burst open at the right time to disperse the seeds, as you can see here. All these movements which were just now explained, these do not normally lead to the plant's growth, and that is why these movements are called as growth irrelevant movements. So, what were the growth relevant movements which we learned? We learned about phototropic, that is movement towards light, gravitropic, movement towards gravitation, hydrotropic, movement towards water, chemotropic, movement towards chemical, thigmotropic, basically movement related to touch. So all these brought about the growth of various parts of the plant. That is why you call it as growth relevant movements. In chemotropic, we learnt a lot of examples about hormones like auxins, gibberellin, cytokinin, and a lot of others, ethylene, abscisic acid, etc. Growth irrelevant movements, we saw a lot of examples like mimosa, that is touch me not. Venus trap, we saw how it traps the insect. blooming of the flowers, we saw the example of lotus flower and tuberose. Fibril of Drosella, we saw how it is trapping the insect, and we also saw bursting of the fruit to disperse the seeds. So here in all these examples, it's not bringing about the growth of the plant, that part of the plant that is involved in these movements. That is why it's called as growth irrelevant movements. Okay, I hope this growth relevant and growth irrelevant movements are clear to everyone. In the next class, we'll be discussing about coordination in human beings. Thank you.